the prices are very good.
I'd like to welcome everybody tonight to the College and Complexes. My name is Tim. I'd like to welcome everybody to this weekly free speech forum. The format for the College and Complexes is we have a very brief announcements period, then our speaker will speak, then we'll have a question and answer period where we will strongly ask that you simply ask questions, because at the end of that question and answer period, you'll all have a chance to sound off for 3 or 4 minutes on the material or not, which is our infamous rebuttal period on the homeless
encampments.
On the homeless encampments of Chicago.
Thank you for having us here. I was here, I think I was talking about ROM a few years ago, and it was really fun, and I don't know what you guys do. My name is Kari Lydersen. I'm a reporter, and Lloyd DeGrane is a photographer. I don't actually work for the Tribune, but one of our stories ended up in the Tribune. So the program this sort of came out of is at Northwestern University in the graduate journalism program. I teach there and sort of co-direct this fellowship program that focuses, it's professional journalists and graduate students focus on certain topics. So we focused on drug policy and mental health and housing and homelessness, and right now we're focused on environmental justice. So Lloyd and I got started on this project as part of this larger focus on housing and homelessness. As we show the slides, we'll talk more about sort of how it evolved and the kinds of things we were learning. But the program at Northwestern is called the Social Justice News Nexus, and then I also write for other publications, and Lloyd's a photojournalist whose work appears all over.
I just wanted to give a little introduction. I knew just about as much as anybody else here.
Now got the mic.
I knew about homelessness. I would give people maybe some change when I walked by. But that's about all I knew. I knew about some of the problems of homelessness, but I wanted to dig a little bit deeper. And you'll see, you can start going. This is the first group of people, the first encampment that we documented. It's at Canalport and the entranceway to the expressway. This man here had just gotten out of, he had been out of prison just for a couple of years. That's one of the main causes of homelessness, is people getting out of prison and having no other place to go to, no home, no family. So he ended up on the street. During the course of the crime that he committed, he was shot with a shotgun. That's the scar in his arm. So he had been out for a couple of years. He was out in the polar vortex, and he had too much alcohol, fell asleep, and that's what happened to him. That isn't so uncommon among the homeless people to fall asleep from substance abuse or alcoholism or something like that, and then have frostbite enough to lose limbs. This is another woman that lived in that encampment also. It's a very fluid community. So you could go to this community on one day, a week later, nobody will be there, or different people will be there, and that happens throughout Chicago. And this is another person that lived in that community. I'm not sure if he's still there. Like I said, everything changes.
You want to use a mic? You could remove that Velcro off the mic.
Okay. Good idea.
And you can hold it if you want.
Sure. And I'm not sure if Lloyd had mentioned already, this is Canal Port in the...
It comes off the holder.
Okay. You might want to
give it to him.
Right. We'll just pass it back and forth. So is it working?
Yes.
Okay. So this is Canal Port, sort of on the eastern edge of the Pilsen neighborhood. And as we were doing this reporting, it's been, I guess, about a year and a half, that we've been spending a lot of time, Lloyd even more than me, he's out there really constantly in different homeless encampments. There's a lot of different themes that emerged, and health problems is obviously a big one, and the difficulties people have getting health care, just the horrible things that happen, like the frostbite. And, you know, you might wonder why someone's not in a shelter on a night like that. I'll save that for a little later, talking about the shelter system and just some of the other things that have come up. But,
So this man, he also committed a burglary. He was robbing copper from a house that had been abandoned. He didn't know, though, that the electricity was not turned off. So when he grabbed some of the copper wire, he was electrocuted. And he's in that homeless encampment as well. And these are just some of the other people that are there. I'm going to transition from that community to another community that was that would be around 18th Street and close to the Chicago River, right near Chinatown. This is the first person I met there. I was just told about this encampment, so I started just exploring a little bit. And he's one of the few Asian people that I met that were homeless, living outside. I'm really focused on the chronically homeless, the people that live outside all year round, of which there are, I don't know, close to 3,000 people, they estimate, in Chicago.
You had vinegar and oil?
Oh, sure.
And his name is Kent, so I stayed with him. He became my guide through some of the fields that we're south of Roosevelt Road along the Chicago River. This is him. Kent had been out for, he was homeless for 8 years. He lived in that little cave right there underneath the viaduct. This is one of the first person that he introduced me to. His name was John. When I first met John, the only part of him that he would show me was his hand. But then after a few weeks, I got to know him a little better. And next slide. And then he let me photograph him. But mental illness also runs rampant in these communities. John is somewhat mentally ill. He had a little bit of a wart, he thought, by his eye, and decided one night to carve it out with a pocket knife. So that's why you see that that lotion right under his eye.
Working?
I'll just give it a minute. And this area, so it's the big, people have probably seen it, the huge swath of land south of Roosevelt and north of 18th Street by the river. The Reader, we did a story for the Chicago Reader there, and the editors actually kind of coined the term Rescoville because Tony Resco, the developer who went to prison, had owned it at one point. And so for years, many years, it was a huge, there might have been 100 or more people living there homeless, but just within the past few months, it's been completely cleared, and all these people you're seeing pictures of now have had to find other places to live. I'll actually talk about this slide. So these men, and I'll click as I talk about it. This was a story that we actually, a pretty big story that we broke for a story that ended up in The Guardian. So there's a bunch of Latino men from Mexico and Guatemala, Honduras, El Salvador, that lived, this isn't actually in the field, this is under the 18th Street Bridge right by King Tom Park. And it turns out, just through talking to them, we found out that they work in Chinese restaurants all over the Midwest, and they're basically essentially trafficked by this sort of network of employment agencies and Chinese restaurant owners all over the Midwest, Ohio, Michigan, Illinois, Kentucky, Missouri, Wisconsin, to these Chinese buffet restaurants, you know, often in strip malls or small towns or off the highways. And there's two employment agencies in Chicago that are being investigated by the Attorney General for civil rights and labor law violations because these men will pay $200 to get a job in one of these restaurants, and then the restaurants pay them below minimum wage. They break all kinds of labor laws in their payment, not to mention that they need to work about a week to earn back that $200. So, and then they usually will end up getting fired or quit after a couple of weeks, and then they end up, so that the restaurants also put them up in housing in the cities that they're in, and then when they get fired or quit, they get a bus back to Chicago, end up homeless here again. And the employment agency owners, the employment agencies are in Pilsen and Chinatown, they know, they really depend on this homeless camp as part of their whole system to keep sending this cheap, you know, illegally cheap labor, illegal meaning the wages, you know, the treatment and the wages are illegal. So it's a really illegal and exploitive situation, and these men, you know, don't have other options, or at least that they can access. This is really sad. This guy here, Angel, actually died a few months ago. He was a wonderful guy, really, really great guy. And there are still, even though the fields have been cleared out, this camp under the bridge, there's still some people living there and still working in those restaurants. This is Jose, actually the first person we met who was part of that encampment, and he had gotten robbed and beaten up. Since they're paid in cash, they're also, you know, big targets for robbery, and, you know, more health problems. This is still all part of that encampment. Yeah, just more injuries, people had suffered. So this is now moving on back to the fields, which is, you know, the area just north of the bridge that I had showed you.
And so these are actually communities within a community. You can go ahead now. Do you see the downtown buildings? Yeah. And I, while I was going along documenting this, I ran into people from the night ministry who actually come out and treat people out in the fields. And we kind of formed an alliance where I would sometimes guide them into the homeless encampments, and then they would follow me, and then they'd meet some of the people that really needed their help. So this is moving now north from 18th Street under that bridge, and we're just moving towards Harrison Street slowly. So these are the fields, and these are some of the people that lived in the fields, which are no longer there. They're being developed by the city. But this is what it looked like just a year ago. People made shelters, they made barricades. This guy here had made just like a fortress around his tent because of theft that occurs in some of the homeless encampments. So people are homeless, but some are more desperate than others. Homeless people get robbed all the time. Terry, he had been there for, I don't know, six years or so. He's from Memphis. And all these people were displaced when just a few months ago. So all of the none of this exists anymore. I also wanted to kind of bring out this guy here. I wanted to show you a little bit about what they do during the day. So a lot of people that lived in the fields panhandle in the streets of Chicago. That's how they made their money. So when you walk downtown and you see people panhandling, they're living pretty close to the loop, or right under where you might be walking, as in the case of Lower Wacker. So in the fields, I met this person too. Actually, Kari and I both, one morning, were just exploring. His name is Jeffrey, and he lived in that tube. He hadn't washed, I don't think, in over a year. Here's the next picture. And that's what his hands were like when I photographed him. This is Jimmy. He lived out in the fields as well. This is the night ministry again. They were bringing in UIC medical students to kind of help out and serve the homeless. Now you move even a little bit farther north. And this is Harrison Street right at the river in what was Tent City. No longer existing as of just a couple of months ago, but this was last year.
Sure. Yeah, so, and this is also that stretch from Harrison South. So the number of people that were displaced when they cleared this tent city, there's development going up right there. It may already be a building, actually. And then, the other fields, there have been so many homeless people displaced from those two locations. A lot of them ended up under Lower Wacker, which we'll talk more about a little bit later. But, you hear so much about displacement from gentrification and, from affordable housing being closed and things like that. And then there's even displacement of, of people from homeless encampments. And also just a little more context of, how a lot of people we met ended up where they were. Most people had worked, full-time, decent jobs in the past. We met a lot of people who were laid off from factories that closed, or like Jimmy had a flooring business that during the economic crisis and, some other situations went downhill. A lot of people directly, a guy who had been a union machinist and, isn't able to get work in that field anymore. And interestingly enough, he's a Trump voter, even though he's living homeless and, not going to benefit from Trump's tax cuts and all that. A lot of people's, the really complicated mosaics of mental health issues and substance abuse, and in some cases, felonies that would make it hard to get other housing or hard to get a job, or even just simple things like not having IDs. Some people that wanted to get into methadone treatment were having trouble because they didn't have an ID, because their backpack had been stolen, and then, if you don't have your birth certificate, then getting a new ID is a whole hassle. And a lot of people, or a number of people at least, who live in these homeless encampments are actually working. There's a guy that works at Marshall's, and Jimmy's still working on and off flooring. A lot of people are, because their wages are too low or other reasons, are actually, holding down regular jobs but living in this situation at night. Still that.
This is one of the people that I met. He was very well known in the homeless community. His name was Elmo. He's from the south. He came to Chicago on the train, and we're still meeting people that they're called train hoppers. I guess they used to be called hobos, but that's what Elmo was. But he ended up staying in Chicago now for a couple of years. So I first met him, he built this shack. He was pretty industrious, and he helped other people when people would come to Chicago and have nothing. He sometimes let them sleep in his shack. That changed somewhat, but started stumbling into, like I said, I started uncovering layers of what's going on in homeless encampments. And homeless encampments, for the most part, are invaded by rats. Usually at night. Elmo, I gave him a couple of traps, and he caught two in a matter of like 20 minutes. Next one. Then in about 2 hours, he caught those. So, but rats are just, in the evening, they just come out, and they just run over people's blankets. People sometimes find them in their sleeping bags. It's really just incredible. And this is another area right in that same location. I had given the guy in the back, Jimmy, a couple of traps also, and that's what he caught in just a couple of hours. Then we went to the north side, and we met a guy that was kind of an expert in rats, it's rodent infestation in the homeless community, and he told us about rat trails. So the rats in those areas live under damaged trees, and they get down into the roots, unlike other areas. And that's Charles. He's pointing out a rat trail, which comes right from a hole down into the homeless encampments. And they go back and forth so much that you could actually see a trail.
Right.
And that's Elmo again. Elmo had a cat for a while who pretty much took care of the rats around where he's at. Pretty mean cat too.
Yeah.
Then, after being really exploring the community, we got we get hit kind of like with a sledgehammer and found out about heroin and its impact on the homeless communities and how it's forcing so many people into homelessness and increasing the amount of people that are homeless. So these are dime bags of heroin that people buy when they panhandle, they get them that way. And that's Elmo. He fell in love with that woman, Jen. She, though, was a heroin addict and brought Elmo down with her. What's that? So this is just some of the things that we had seen. When people's veins kind of collapse, they shoot in different parts of their body, and they hit, there's a main vein right here, the groin, that's what a lot of people go to after their arms and legs can't be used anymore. So heroin is really something it's an epidemic in America, and also in the Chicago homeless community.
And people, I mean, it's been in the news so much, everyone's probably read about the heroin and opioid crisis and the roots of it. Just some, like, real basics, you know, it really, heroin's been around, obviously, for a long time, but within the past 15 years or so, there's been this explosion in rural and suburban, you know, mostly white people using it at just exponentially much higher rates, and that really started with the painkiller, pill mills, and, you know, people, doctors over-prescribing painkillers and those getting out into the black market, and then actually, sort of ironically, when there was more crackdown on painkillers and they became a little bit harder to get through prescriptions, heroin is cheaper, so people who are addicted to the painkillers switch to heroin, and I mean, the painkiller addiction is a big problem and is really a terrible thing, but the death rates for people who are using painkillers are much, much lower because, you know, people at least know what they're getting and can sort of regulate their use a little bit more, and heroin, the overdose rates have been climbing really exponentially too, partly because it's often mixed with fentanyl, with synthetic opioids that are much stronger than heroin, and then, you know, people are even seeking out the stronger batches that hit the streets. So this crisis that's Trump actually just appointed a commission on the opioid epidemic, and, you know, previous to that, it had been declared a state of emergency in some states, and so it's something that's happening all over the country, and here, you know, in Chicago, a lot of the homeless, especially the younger white people who are homeless, you know, a lot of that is directly traceable to the heroin epidemic.
And then also, as people got to trust me more and more, you know, they would just shoot up right in front of me. So, I mean, they were, you know, very obvious once they got to trust me being out in the field with them. So this is just some of the ways that people were using heroin out there, and it's rampant. This is something that happens to a lot of heroin addicts, and their hands swell. It's got something to do with the circulation system. I'm not a doctor, but you can, if you see people panhandling, take a look at their hands. You'll know. Swollen hands are a dead giveaway for heroin addiction.
Sorry.
Yeah.
These are kind of graphic. Sorry.
I think we can show that one. I just wanted to show you some of the things that happens to people. Past one, I think, it's pretty graphic, but people have abscesses, you know, all over their limbs. These are two of the people that died that I know, that both OD'd. So far I've known about a half a dozen people. This is a story that Kari is working on. And this is, we're still in that camp near Harrison Street.
Excuse me. If you hold the mic like he is, about this.
Like this? Yeah.
About a fist away from your. A fist is about the best way to do it.
Okay, like this.
Yes.
Okay, great. So in terms of, you know, in reporting on the heroin crisis, I mean, there's just so many horrible stories of people. It's such a hard addiction to kick. The withdrawal symptoms are just so awful that, you know, people will do pretty much anything to avoid going through that. So I guess part of the goal of this reporting is just to help people understand better, you know, to kind of, it's like cliche, but sort of put a human face on some of the stories and, you know, help people understand like how someone ends up having an addiction and just how hard it is to break that. So this couple, so this woman, Rhonda, actually died last summer from an infection related to her heroin use. And the man, he's actually okay with us sharing his story. This man, Dan, was her boyfriend, partner. And they're from Jamestown, New York. So I actually went to Jamestown last month and reported on the opioid crisis there. Jamestown is like a really classic Rust Belt town where it used to be the furniture capital of the country, furniture making capital, and the factories closed and, you know, unemployment went up, and it's just one of those kind of quintessential struggling places. And then drug addiction, painkiller addiction became really, really big there, and then heroin, you know, became big after or along with that. So Dan and Rhonda actually met at this place called the Bullfrog Hotel. I should have brought a picture of it. It's an SRO single room occupancy hotel that's above a bar. That's actually, it's kind of interesting. It's actually owned by a family who are one of Trump's big campaign operatives in New York. And it's a really interesting, you know, it's one of those things that makes you question sort of obvious assumptions about places like the Bullfrog Hotel. The living conditions there are pretty terrible. Everyone that lives there says, you know, they're just there because it's a last resort. But it's a place where a lot of people like Dan and Rhonda, who ended up without any other options, are living, and a lot of people on disability who can't afford other rent. So, you know, there's some pressure in the town to shut down the Bullfrog Hotel. And if I just wandered in off the street, I would probably think it should be shut down. But then you meet people like Dan and Rhonda, who, you know, had nowhere else to live. Anyway, they made it to Chicago, you know, struggling to survive and survive their addiction. And Rhonda ended up passing away last summer, and Dan is still on and off trying to get into treatment, but not having much success. He's just an example of how hard it can be. And one thing he said that really stuck with me is he wants to get off heroin so badly, but he's also sort of terrified of actually getting off heroin because it's his whole life and it's all that he does. And he doesn't even know like what his life will be without heroin. I asked him, like, dream, like, where do you want to go? What would you do if you were to pick up a hobby? And he just like didn't know because heroin's been so all-consuming in his life for so long.
So I want to warn you, the next couple of slides are pretty graphic, but this is what happened to Rhonda. So they would be in the in their shelter. A lot of times, heroin addicts need somebody to shoot them up because they can't find veins. So that's what Rhonda was doing with Dan. That's Dan by the river. That's an infection that he had from shooting up in his groin. And this is Rhonda. I photographed her the day or the night before I brought her into the hospital. She died like a week later. She just couldn't stop. So she let her arm, the skin actually fell off of her arm. And it was very sad. This is Dan. I had to then tell Dan that she died because they wouldn't let him into the hospital. So this is him like the day after. Then I just want to show you a few other things. Some of the homeless people are living in storage facilities. They rent a locker and then just stay there for as long as they can until they're discovered. This is the north side now. These people were alcoholics. And that was under Foster. So there's all, you know, Foster, Lawrence Avenue, Wilson. Anybody that's taken the drive and gotten off at any of those exits have seen the tents and all of the people there. And this is just some of it. And it's funny because some of the communities up there are made up of what people do to really abuse themselves. Foster happened to be a community of alcoholics. These were some of the people. Lawrence, on the other hand, this was like Lawrence Avenue. There were mentally ill people there as well. That's another one of the main causes of homelessness.
People have probably seen this has been like big news for a while, just the battles over the city trying to remove people under the viaducts, and you know, really pretty amazing community activism and solidarity. And then, you know, James Kaplman's the alderman there, was actually a social worker. They're still there. I don't know what the latest sort of legal situation is, but that's been but with summer coming is always when there's more pressure, from the city or some neighbors to get people moved out, so it'll probably be flaring up again.
The other thing too about the people in the north side viaducts, the economics of that area is a little bit different. People don't panhandle that much because they only need to get like enough for a beer or a vodka or something like that, as opposed to the heroin addicts who are downtown who sometimes need up to $150 a day. Dan and Rhonda made that much, even up to $200 a day. We estimated that they made about $50,000 a year, all of it went to their veins. And now, this is just kind of a random sampling of some of the places. This was Mount Harrison on the other side. Go ahead. And one of the communities I'm just now focusing on is Lower Wagger Drive. So it's a place where working people share this whole place with a lot of homeless people.
Yeah, in Lower Wacker, I mean, a lot of people describe Lower Wacker as kind of a last resort. The noise and the pollution, you know, as you can imagine, is terrible, and there's been a lot of violence there. It's definitely a less ideal place to live than those fields. So, you know, one of the unfortunate things about those fields being cleared out is more people ending up on Lower Wacker and, you know, probably exacerbating the tensions and the violence more. And although one thing that has been neat to see on Lower Wacker is how regular, you know, passersby are often really helpful and sympathetic to people. And you know, you often see people handing out food, or one woman handed out gloves that had money hidden in them, which was kind of a neat gesture. And the police seem to, you know, actually have a relatively good relationship, or sort of live and let live relationship with people down there for the most part. So there's a lot of, you know, there is actually a lot of good charity and, you know, people volunteering to help people in these homeless encampments, which is great and is really important, but it also kind of underscores just how tricky of a problem chronic homelessness is, because, you know, getting food isn't really the issue. Like, you know, people usually are able to have enough food, often too much food that ends up rotting and attracting rats. So, you know, it's just such deeper issues that so many resources need to be poured into to really even have a chance of helping, you know, an individual person get out of chronic homelessness.
So I saw one of the women down there. She's 23. She's a train rider. That was tattooed onto her hand. But it, to me, kind of like that tattoo on her hand says a lot about living conditions in their Lower Wacker. It is insanity. And these are a couple of the people that we met that live there. And Kari interviewed several of these people.
Yeah, his name's Edward, really great guy. His parents had actually lived under Lower Wacker at various points, and his mother recently passed away. Just really good guy, trying, you know, unsuccessfully so far to get out of there. And this guy, Sal, grew up in Little Village in the 60s, and is on disability and trying to get housing, but, you know, he's applied for these different programs that give you housing, but hasn't gotten any yet.
No ice cream.
A lot of creative signs people will come up with. And just click through some. That's Elmo, the one, so he lives under Lower Wacker now after, you know, we had this really cool shack by the river. Like, I would have enjoyed living in that shack when it was warm. You know, yeah, so it was a pretty nice place he had set up for himself by the river, and now he's under Lower Wacker in a much, much less, much worse situation. But he's so good with animals. He's was able to sort of hypnotize this pigeon, and apparently he does that for tourists to get, you know, to get money a lot of times. So really interesting guy. That's actually from one of the protests over the...
That's the end.
Oh, that's the end. So, okay, we were quick.
So we leave you with this message.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
You guys are going to take questions now, if you don't mind, and I think Andy might be up, but if not, just pick on a raised hand or two. I'm going to take the first one. In the reporting, what is the main factor that drives somebody homeless? And in those who are transient, what is the main factor that can pull them out of being homeless?
Yeah, so I mean, there's not necessarily one main factor, but the big factors are mental illness and substance abuse, which is often self-medicating for mental illness, and then a lot of times criminal backgrounds, you know, which makes it harder to get a job or housing. And a lot of, you know, people, like the lack of affordable housing and the economy definitely are a big part of it. But, you know, there's different levels of homelessness, and so this is really chronic homelessness. So, you know, most people, I think, out here, in the chronic homeless, like a lost job or, you know, rising housing costs might have put them up on the street initially, and then it's usually more complicated factors that are keeping them on the street. So in terms of what can help, the kind of prevailing public policy solution right now, which is a great one, is called Housing First, and it's basically the idea that you just give someone housing, no strings attached, you know, you don't demand that they stop using substances, you just give them housing and you pay for that housing, and you give them social services, although access to social services, but you don't require that they use social services, you know, you don't require they go to counseling or get into drug treatment. So that is, you know, right now the best evidence-based solution to homelessness, but the problem is that it's massively expensive, and also it needs some resistance because, you know, people who aren't chronically homeless are like, why is someone who's, you know, a drug addict and a criminal and homeless, you know, why is the government paying for their housing and they're not paying for my housing? So there is some opposition to that, but there's been, like, I think it was the New Yorker had a story that perfectly laid it out called, I think it was called Million Dollar Murphy, if I'm remembering right.
Malcolm Gladwell.
It was Malcolm Gladwell, yeah, right. So that showed that, you know, even if you're, like, heartless and all you care about is the bottom line, for the taxpayers' benefit, this Housing First does actually pay off in the long run, because the money that taxpayers save on emergency room and, you know, incarceration for homeless people, that money is better spent and less money is spent if you give them housing and access to social services.
Right. Just call on somebody, and if you need help with Andy,
yeah.
Was there any effort, did you see, to hand out Narcan, or?
Oh, yeah, good question. Do you want to talk about that?
Yeah. I actually, I was trained by the Med Ministry to give needles out to people as well, and I carry Narcan with me. And when the Med Ministry also gives out clean needles, to people, they give out thousands of needles a week. They were mandated just to flood the market with clean needles. They brought out several medical people with them just about a month ago to test people under Lower Wacker for Hep C and HIV. out of the 12 people they tested, all of them had Hep C and two had HIV.
What's Hep C?
Hepatitis C. So that is why they pass out so many clean needles, but you still see people sharing needles or picking them up off the ground. And it's costing taxpayers just millions and millions and millions of dollars. I mean, Rhonda, the woman who you saw, was in intensive care for over a week, and a team of doctors working on her. You know, I don't know what that costs, but, and we met other people that were staying in the hospital with abscesses for like 2 months at a time.
Yeah. I wonder if there's a difference in the number of people that are homeless from winter to summer. If it's cold, they go somewhere else.
They do. And you'll see a greater influx of people this summer because the train riders come into Chicago. One of the things that appeal to a lot of homeless people that ride the train is that Chicago is kind of eased up on panhandling regulations. So it's easier in this city to make money than it is in other places.
Just real quick, sorry. And the city does a count of the homeless. Well, actually, the whole country does a count, and that's in January. So they sort of consider the, that's the homeless numbers you see would be from Windsor. And they'll also count people on trains and in emergency rooms, just who are just there for the, not like for medical, but in the waiting rooms. So they're still like considered homeless, you know, even if they're actually indoors at that moment.
So you've mentioned.
Oh gosh, I'm forgetting off the top of my head, but I can look it up easily and give it to you. The actual number from the last count. But I'll let you know before then. Yeah.
Okay, so you mentioned the night ministry a couple times. So we don't know really like the origins of it. Is it an actual like religious? The thing, or what is the night ministry? Can you explain that?
I'll get that fixed. Just give me a second.
So the night ministry, it's a, I think it is somewhat, is faith-based somehow in its origins, but they have a, it's basically a, they're not proselytizing, people can go to their website to see more. I don't want to like speak on behalf of the organization, you know, their philosophy, but they run a shelter for LGBT youth that's really fantastic, and then they do this bus. People might have seen the bus.
What did you order?
Doing meal exchange and services, and
beef shish kebab.
What's the website of the night ministry?
But I've never seen anybody from the night ministry talk about religion to any of the people that they serve. You know, they're really low key about that.
All right.
Yeah, my question is about people with disabilities who are homeless in Chicago. It seems like going to really allocate money to like new basketball stadiums and like in the governor's space when we have brand new expensive renovation to the governor's mansion. Part of the reason why when they have a press conference, it seems where they announce those things that they're so callous about, at least to me, from my standpoint, we've never as a country had a dialogue about how wrong Reagan is. Could you comment on how we've never had a national dialogue specifically people with disabilities for homeless about the failures of Reagan?
It's a good point, you know, it's a great point. That dialogue should definitely happen more than it is. Yeah.
Hi. You say be more kind. Are you telling us we should go out to these homeless people and bring them into our homes and give them food?
Yes.
Wait. Or are you saying that government should be more, or government should be more kind?
Government's supposed to be responsible.
I think it's just a general message, you know, to be more understanding of people.
Uh-huh.
That's kind of like what I get from that sign. You know?
And I think, you know, definitely government, because, I mean, I think the most important thing, even more than giving people stuff, is just to sort of acknowledge their humanity and acknowledge them as, you know, people. But it's the government's job to be, the government should be.
Yeah, and while we work for them, like we did sometimes crazy campaign, while we work, people work for the government to help people ordinary people. And look at these poor people like this. They need to help. Because
all right.
Choose them, to work for us.
Are the West Coast cities still the worst for homeless? Like Phoenix?
Okay.
Yeah. Oh, it's the West Coast cities are the worst. Yeah, I think, I mean, that would be interesting to look up the actual numbers and per capita.
I think the West Coast is much
worse. Like San Diego, Sacramento. You know, depending how you measure.
We've missed it, but they're making it.
I'm
going to request that all questioners please raise their voices so we can pick the question up at the camera with the built-in microphone.
Or we can repeat the question.
Or they can repeat the question.
Repeat it. We can repeat
okay.
It.
Next, please.
Do the homeless have rights? Because on Staten Lake, they're sleeping on the street in front of the Chicago Theater. The police are not allowed to tell them to move on. And the only way you can move them under the viaduct is in the summer when they tell them to move, to put a hose to clean the area. But they have rights, right?
Yeah. I mean, there's detailed laws about panhandling and, you know, relating to where you're allowed to stay or sleep and, you know, when you can be moved. And the Coalition for the Homeless is a really active, you know, they really, because like any rights, whether you have them or not, it doesn't mean they're necessarily respected. But the Coalition for the Homeless does have lawyers who are, you know, working on that issue.
That's what the police say. They do something and the lawyers are right on them.
Yeah, that may be true. Yeah.
What's your take on, let's say we build shelters for them, and then since they get robbed all the time, some are afraid to use them, why don't we have police guards to protect them while they're in the thing? I mean, it sounds like it's totalitarian, but these people are being robbed, why not have the police protect their housing?
Yeah, I mean, it's an idea, yeah. But I think the police couldn't really be everywhere. I mean, the police do circulate on Lower Wacker. Now and then the police would go into those fields, but, you know, even if they wanted to, like, the police couldn't really be everywhere guarding people. And then in the shelters, so in the shelter system, like, when it's cold out, there's an emergency shelter system where, you know, anyone can get a spot for that night, so make sure you're warm. But those can be pretty, you know, that's where it might be, like, mats on the floor. You know, those can be pretty crowded and kind of substandard. And some of the shelters you hear horror stories about, I'll just say by name, Pacific Guard Mission, which is a privately run, that's not part of the city's shelter system. You hear horror stories about physical assaults and robberies inside that shelter.
The police stand guard there.
Yeah, I mean, they have their own security, but apparently the security is part of the problem there, from what you hear.
And also the Pacific Guard Commission has now become a dumping ground for the Illinois prison system.
Yes.
So now they've got vans coming on occasion, just unloading people that just got out of the prison right into the mission. So the people that are homeless that choose to go into that mission as a shelter are, you know, sharing that with somebody that just came out of prison. So you've got, you know, like a powder keg of anything that could possibly happen. But the chronically homeless people that I've talked to, they think that there are too many bed bugs, body lice, rodents, thievery that goes on in shelters that they just don't want to be there.
I've actually heard something of, and it's called the Hope House, and it's down in one of the more southern side of communities. Ran by a local church through them, and they actually take people from the Illinois prison system and house them for a number of months and help them get off things. Have you seen more or less like churches or private charity help these out, or is it just...
I see people, you know, from churches on occasion, like going through the communities, giving away food and clothing as well, but I haven't seen like any church like take anybody off the street, you know, and house them. I mean, that's just a lot to do, and it's a lot of money to be able to do it. These people have a lot of problems other than just shelter. I mean, you know, you can't, I don't think, put somebody in an apartment and kind of forget about them because there's so many other problems. they'll be right back out on the street again.
Oh, and I just also want to kind of like complete the thought on shelters. There's actually some shelters doing really good work, and you know, there's shelter is sort of a catch-all term, but there's transitional housing programs, and you know, basically the city has an intake center that you go to on Kedzie if you want to get placed in a shelter. And I mean, people have complaints about everywhere, but you know, there's some actually decent shelters, but getting into, especially into a longer-term transitional housing, you know, sometimes that can be difficult, or people want to be in a certain part of the city, and the city won't necessarily place you in the shelter you want to be in. It depends on availability and stuff, so a lot of times people will leave a shelter if it's not the part of the city they want to be in. So, you know, it's a lot more complicated. Even if we opened, I mean, it would be good to open more shelters, but, you know, that's not as, yeah, it's just really complicated. I don't know.
Over here.
To pick on.
And then you got a couple over here.
Okay. I'm going to. So, as the author of Paper 1%, and you're working for the Tribune?
Actually, not working for the Tribune.
Okay. Yeah. Well, here, you know, you mentioned the cost of living. You know, it's true that the homeless have problems with drug abuse, mental illness, and all of that. But, you know, the median rent in Chicago right now is $1,600, a little over that, a month. And when you take that out to a year, it comes out to about $20,000, which implies if we still had the cost of housing where it used to be, you'd have to be making $80,000 a year. So it's, you know, this is kind of like the ugly manifestation of that. Is there anything being done to, you know, connect the dots to the developers, the real estate developers, who borrow money, you know, highly leveraged money, and make huge profits, and, you know, 1% again? Is there anything happening with it?
There are a couple of good ordinances that help. There's like way more that needs to be done, and it certainly seems like there should be more of a, you know, a tax on developers and all sorts of things to that the city could do, you know, that the mayor and city council could do to improve the affordable housing situation.
They should
situation.
Be paying for the homeless.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, I'd agree with that, yeah. And there is an ordinance that makes it harder to shut down the single-room occupancy hotels, so that's a good thing. And there is an affordable housing ordinance that mandates some affordable housing be built with developments of a certain size. So there's a few things, but there definitely needs to be a lot more.
Okay. She's got a question.
Yeah, very quick. I promise. Very quick.
All right, loud, please.
Yeah, very quick. So,
Well, how
people give money, even like water, spare, like whatever, charity, they don't comprehend it. They continue to do what they do. Then why people give money to those people? I'm so sorry. No. They don't know how to handle it.
I mean, personally, I usually don't give people money, especially because if they are going to spend it on heroin, like, I don't want
exactly.
it. So, but I think it's just up to each person. I wouldn't say you should or shouldn't give people money.
Maybe some piece of bread.
Okay.
Yeah, right.
All right. Sid hasn't had a question yet.
Yeah, I was wondering, you ever made a study of some of the social democratic countries, like Scandinavia, or even Western Europe, Britain, Germany, about homelessness there and how they contend with that problem?
I haven't studied that in depth, but I know that a lot of those countries have a pretty progressive approach, and say with, you know, with drugs, they have a much more, they treat it as a public health issue and deal with drug abuse a lot more effectively, which is so related to homelessness. So I know there's models out there that, you know, we should be looking at more.
In Vancouver right now in Canada is one approach they have is actually setting up clinics for heroin addicts, and they've been treating people. People come in like 3 times a day. The cost of the clinics for each person is about $18,000 a year. It was estimated that heroin addicts were costing the city about $40,000 a year before these clinics started, like in cost of medical and crime and things like that too. So that's, you know, the way they're doing it is saving money.
tight. I think he hasn't had a question yet. Go ahead.
Yeah. In your opinion, obviously drugs have a lot to do with the problem of people becoming homeless and out of control. In your opinion, would legalization of drugs and control and taxation of those drugs help solve the problem, in your opinion? And it would take the profit out of illegal drugs.
Yeah. I just mentioned about Vancouver, and if you just want to do it by the money and saving. But you know, this has got a ripple effect now. I mean, if you just take it with just a couple of people, so you've got, say like one of these people that you saw, they go to the west side, they jump on the blue line from downtown, they go to the west side to buy, it's called the Heroin Highway, it's around Pulaski, California, right down the Eisenhower. So you could leave downtown with maybe $10 or $20, that's enough to buy one or two packs of heroin, and you just kind of walk the streets and somebody will just walk up to you and sell it to you right there. And that's controlled by somebody bigger that's making money, but a lot of the people that are dealing on the street are just trying to hustle for their own addiction. But then, and that's a very high crime area, and that's one of the biggest causes of the crime.
I guess my question is, if you make it legal, won't you eliminate most of that?
You would.
So,
right.
Well, you would. So for heroin, I think, making marijuana legal would help in the sense that people wouldn't have as much criminal records, but I don't think the marijuana, one way or another, figures that much into the, for the heroin, if it was legal, in the way it is, I think legal is actually the wrong word, because if it was decriminalized and then had a robust public health approach to still help people get off it, because, you see what it does to people, and that would happen if it was legal, too. So just legalizing heroin definitely, wouldn't be the answer, and that would never be a possibility, but having it, decriminalized and, just a better way that people could legally get off it. Yeah.
What's happened the past 10 years, aside from the Obama administration, why there's so many white males, a lowered life expectancy, they're unemployed, they're on drugs. What happened the past 8 years?
Obama.
Well, so you might have seen this study or heard about it about a year ago that showed that white middle-aged people death rates are going up, men and women actually, whereas death rates for people of color and for white Europeans are going down, and it's because of suicide, alcoholism, and drug abuse rates among middle-aged white people are really going up. And they call it diseases of despair, the wisdom. Is that because of the economic crisis and because, people realize the American dream isn't happening for them, they're turning to alcohol and drugs and committing suicide.
That's why Trump won.
Okay. It's a part. Actually, let me just say one fact that's really interesting on that note. There was a study that the counties that turned from Democratic to Trump voters was directly correlated with rates of opioid abuse, even controlling for income and other factors. So, it's definitely a relationship.
I just want to ask you a quick question from the audience. Could I see a show of hands for people that think heroin should be legalized? Most people don't think so. They're, that tells you something just among the public at large.
Although it's worth noting, our state, Illinois, actually passed a pretty progressive heroin bill in 2015 that took some steps toward decriminalizing it and making it easier to treat.
Okay.
That's why it's taking so long.
All right, where, Andy? David, give them about 10 minutes. I want to get some background on these guys and why they did it after our questions are done. David.
Have either one of our speakers ever been homeless?
I have.
I've been on the road for about a year traveling through America, but I wouldn't consider myself homeless because I always had a family.
All right.
From the far back?
Charlie.
It seems to me like there's a lot more housing with very few people in it. Do you know of any things like occupancy standards? And I kept thinking, what about people? Aren't in New York, they used to have tremendous overcrowding. Did you have any evidence or encounter anything like that?
I'm sorry, I didn't understand.
Well, there's several things, yeah.
Well, I don't know if this is what you meant, but I mean, there is a sort of a small, like, squatters, like, organized squatters movement in Chicago of, you know, people going into homes that are vacant, that have been foreclosed on, and just starting to live there. Like, that's happening on a very small scale.
Cool.
And then, yeah, and then a lot of, you know, and they're doing it, like, very intentionally. And then also a lot of homeless people, especially in the back of the arts.
Probably artists, too, but I've seen
in the back of the arts. Will just break into, you know, old houses and live, I mean, in vacant houses and live there.
Okay. All right. I'd like to get a little bit about your background and why you chose to do this article. So I guess maybe a little bit of a brief biographical sketch and why you're doing this series of articles.
I can go first. So I mean, I've been a reporter for about 20 years, focused a lot on social justice issues, including housing. I've been focused on housing a lot. I actually used to work at Streetwise newspaper, which is the, you know, the homeless street paper. So I've been interested in this topic for a long time, and on the root causes and solution, you know, portfolio solutions for issues like homelessness and addiction. That's enough. I teach at Northwestern University, and I've been working on this project. Lloyd and I have been working on this project. It started as part of that fellowship at Northwestern, and I actually, both of us work with Northwestern students on this issue too.
My background is, I was a photographer with the Chicago Reader for quite a while, and also with the New York Times for about 8 years, and then I freelance for the Tribune and just many other publications. I did one book on how people watch TV, and then did a major study on life in Cook County Jail and Steak Mill. I spent about 6 years working on that project too. I am involved with social issues, and I just delve deeply into this particular topic because I think there's so much to be uncovered and so much I think that the American people should know about concerning homelessness.
Most important question of the night, Cubs or Sox fans?
I live in Bridgeport, so.
Okay.
Yeah, I'll say Sox.
Okay.
Listen, you've been talking about people homeless. You've been is it accurate to describe people who are homeless as people who are without shelter, or are the people who are in shelters, as you just, are they also counted as homeless?
Yes, both.
And there's the city, if you go to the city's website, they have official definitions of like 3 or 4 different types of homelessness and what exactly falls into those. Because people can be homeless and actually living in a home, but you know, if it's a temporary situation. But the shelters, people in shelters would be counted as part of the chronic, I think, depending on the shelter.
All right. Andy?
Over here. I know you said you don't give money, but anybody who does give a buck or whatnot, I always ask their first name, just to get some human relationship to them, rather than just give them a dollar and one. It leads to a little conversation sometimes. Do you have any suggestions on what can be done, from what you've seen? First of all, in these encampments, are most of them drug addicts? I know a lot of, what percentage of homeless people in Chicago are not drug addicts, you know? And those that are drug addicts, boy, I don't know, what can be done? Do you have any suggestions?
This kind of marijuana.
I think it's got to go by the community, just like, you know, some of the pictures that you had seen. Like, there are communities of alcoholics. There are, I think, downtown Chicago, I would say maybe 75% to 80% of the people that you see panhandling are drug addicts, either you know, with heroin or some other drug. So that's pretty high, especially if you see white people that are under 30. You could pretty much guess and look at the hands, you know. And there aren't too many people that are doing other things other than really, you know, they've staked out that territory in downtown Chicago, because the people that they're really interested in getting money from are people that aren't that aware of what's going on, like maybe a suburbanite coming into Chicago, you know, or a tourist coming into Chicago. And, you know, downtown Chicago, that's what you've got a lot of. And they're, you know, they just feel sorry for people. Where I think people that live in the city, they're a little bit more callous about things like that.
In the back. Go ahead. What's your question?
I worked on the very first, worked on the very first cannabis dispensary in the city of Chicago. So they have a really great infrastructure now. They have growers, transportation, security. I believe there's 80 stores throughout the state. How can people make the transition from, and it's really powerful marijuana now, really kick-ass marijuana, as they used to say in college. Yeah, can people on heroin make the transition to really powerful kick-ass marijuana? Do you have any experience with that or any knowledge of that?
Well, I've actually read, there's been a few articles recently, you might have seen them. It's actually being, you know, sort of endorsed, like there's talk of actual doctors, or that's a strategy that's been talked about in the media. I haven't personally. Actually, no, I take that back. I do know someone who was a heroin addict, and marijuana really helped him get off heroin.
We got infrastructure
there.
They should begin
this
now.
We want to go 7 minutes more, and then
rebuttal. And I mean, to add to sort of on that same note, your question about what would help, just much more money for treatment and much more accessible treatment. Like right now, Medicaid is going to start covering methadone in Illinois, but there's a it looks like the reimbursement rates won't be high enough. So most methadone providers probably won't expand their capacity. So there's a real need for more beds in long-term treatment programs and more affordable methadone, and just to make it easier for people, either without insurance or even with insurance, to get treatment. There's a lot of hurdles. Not all insurance covers treatment, even though it's actually supposed to. And then it looks like Obamacare won't actually be rolled back, so that's a good thing. But if that were to happen, that could make things even worse in terms of people being able to get treatment.
Okay, we got time for a couple more questions, and we're going to go into rebuttals. So two more questions. Who's Jane, David? Take one.
Isn't it a fact that methadone is actually more addictive than heroin?
Yes.
Yeah, my friend Jimmy was doing methadone for a couple of years. He lost all of his teeth. That's one of the side effects. One thing I didn't know was that people that start doing methadone on a smaller scale are still doing heroin as well. So they mix the two drugs. And you don't really kick heroin until you get such a high dose of methadone that you don't need heroin anymore. But the people that are first weaning themselves off are doing both.
Over here, and that's it.
How many people would you get are drug addicts in the Chicago area?
Sorry, I couldn't hear the last part.
What approximates how many thousands of people are drug addicts in the city?
In the city. Well, I think among the homeless, it's a really high percent. I don't know if the city actually has those numbers. I was just looking at the federal numbers, although they're not fresh in my mind. I could tell you later. I can actually tell you that before we leave. I look it up really late.
Okay, let's give a big round of applause to our speakers tonight. And we will enter the famous College of Complexes rebuttal period now. So for those of you that want to make a comment on tonight's presentation or a comment on anything else in the world situation that's affecting this topic, raise your hands and hold them up, and we'll take a count and see how many minutes we can. But we don't want 10 other people to come up here at 8:30 if they didn't raise their hand. So raise your hand now if you want to get a rebuttal. And okay, we got one, keep your hands up, two, three, four, five, six, seven. You want to take a rebuttal, Charlie?
I'm just going to say thank you.
Eight, nine, 10, 11, Jonathan's 12, I'm 13. Okay, we got about 14 people.
Well, about 4 minutes.
So you got about 4 minutes apiece for a rebuttal. I'll run a timer up here. So who's, Jonathan, you going to be first?
Sure.
Okay, Jonathan's up first for the rebuttal. You got 4 minutes.
All right, let's thank our guests again. All right, you guys get it. There's experts.
When you're ready, John.
Thank you very much, speakers. A lot of us hesitate to say this because we don't want it to be misinterpreted. But I'm one of those people who I think radical honesty in the beginning when you say it hurts, but in the long run it feels good. Reaganism is saying that we normalize a failed state. Reaganism is saying that we accept a failed state. Not a failed people. We are not a failed people. I think there's too many people in this country who want to end homelessness and illiteracy and drug addiction and unemployment through reallocating our wealth, which we have to reallocate if we choose to be like some of those countries that we talk about every Saturday night: Iceland, Norway, Sweden, Finland, Denmark. Let us not normalize Trump-Pence-ism like we normalized Reaganism. Let us learn that lesson. It's just like driving a motor vehicle with stone square wheels. It doesn't get anywhere when you drive a vehicle with stone square wheels if you've ever tried it. Let's learn from other countries and have the humility to say we can learn from countries like Iceland and Norway and Sweden and Denmark. We need to transition our civic vehicle to round rubber wheels. That's not a partisan position, that's just a common sense pro-democracy position. This is by Franklin Delano Roosevelt from June 27, 1936. Here in America, we are waging a great and successful war. It is not alone a war against want and destitution and economic demoralization, it is more than that. It is a war for the survival of democracy. The overseers of the system are conducting something far worse than merely working against us. The overseers have declared war on we the people. The dominant system controlled by corporate thieves, corporate murderers, corporate surveyors, and corporate polluters has not and will not ever meet the needs of the people, especially the disability community. Unless there is mass mobilization each and every day, peacefully and democratically, this intolerable corporate coup d'etat will become normalized. Now, some will say now is the time to make nice and negotiate with the oligarchs who now hold majority in all the branches of our City of Chicago government, State of Illinois government, and federal U.S. government. No! No! Now is not the time to make nice. We remember 8 years of obstructionism to someone who was a capitalist, even though he was a democratic capitalist. They say no to things that just doesn't make any sense if they mean what they say and they say what they mean. The only thing that can stop this violent, misogynist, racist, faithist, abilitist, classist, wicked, twisted system is a peaceful, democratic mass mobilization for general strike.
call it a full funding for services and programs of social uplift mobilization. Call it a national block party for We the People. Call it a national dialogue for common sense. Call it an international declaration of enough is enough. Whatever you want to call it, we must recognize that this is an emergency with demands that we respond to it with the highest possible urgency, and one that we can bring our children and our grandchildren and our parents as moms here today. Mom, Linda Barton, raise your hand. Lifetime nurse in Illinois for 33 years, 18 years worked at that job with multiple sclerosis, and they're cutting disability funding now.
Time.
That's time. Thank you very much to the speakers.
I want to thank the speaker for raising issues I was not always aware of, although I'm on the fringe and I watch and try to help. Given the capitalist framework we've got to work with, and it's getting more Darwinistic, thanks to the speaker for bringing that up. But within the structure, I've been proud of a couple things we can do to sort of slice off the onion layer by layer without probably getting to the kernel of the disparity in this country. But the night bus I have to give much credit to for facing up to issues, giving those needles. Let's face it, we're not going to give them Bibles to clean up the hepatitis. We're going to give them clean needles. They've been doing that for, I'll bet, 20 years now in Uptown. I give them credit. Streetwise is an attempt to give the homeless a product and that they can vend it and feel like they're passing on an idea of value. What is it, $3 now?
$2.
Some hard-hitting journalism. Good stories, it's not just make work. I give them credit for that. The mission, and I know the college isn't a Jesus-friendly place here, but you gotta walk the walk, and there are people at Catholic Charities that are walking the walk at the food pantry. The mission, I walked in to see what the hell it was like, and I had lunch at the mission on Canal Street, and it was pretty nourishing. I thought it was okay food. People are on the street all day long waiting for that 4 o'clock meal, and then they're out by 7 a.m., and all the sheets are changed to get the bed bugs out. You gotta do everybody's bunk over, you gotta wash all that. And yes, if you want to, there are Bible discussions, but that's a crew that every day has to clean those bunks and wash those dishes. I give them credit. What can we do? I see a couple things that the technology is trying. You can bring a nylon tent downtown. You can put a sort of a hose onto the ventilation under Wacker or other buildings and draw that and recycle that warm air all winter. Somebody's facing it at a drafting board saying, what could we make to make their lives easier? Doesn't get away from the root cause, but it's keeping some people from freezing toast. That was a tremendous idea, and you can carry the thing in your backpack and hook it up every night. That's one advantage of Lower Wacker at the Hyatt and the Swiss Hotel. There's tremendous ventilation systems that can heat a shelter. It's a tech solution. I think I've touched on that. Plus tiny houses you may be reading about. These tiny wooden structures you can put up in a week, and it's a livable sort of structure. You're not going to get formica top, or what do you call it, granite kitchen garbage and all. You're going to get a roof over your head with low-cost materials you can put together yourself. Why don't you see it around here? Because it works in warm climate. There is no heating or AC. But these are things that architects have given pro bono time to do, and these tiny houses are taking off south of Tennessee all the way to Florida. So there's a technological pro bono solution there.
Time.
Oh, time. Let me say the last thing you can do And my wife taught me this. We go on a trip to a Motel 6 or the Hyatt. Every night they put out, morning they put out the free toothbrushes, the razors, the soap, and the shampoo. Take that, throw it in your suitcase. Every night you're at the hotel, you get a new delivery of it. Use your own damn soap and shampoo, and you take home about a month's supply to somebody who can get a lot out of that bar of soap and a lot out of that razor. It's not the most honest thing to do, but hell, they're making money more, you know, $90 a night on a room. Take a little back.
Okay.
Thanks.
Next, please.
I don't know how many people here read the book or seen the movie a long time ago, The Grapes of Wrath.
Yes.
And I remember this one part in there where they're nearing California, but they haven't reached it yet. And they come across this public housing that's been put out by the Roosevelt administration. And they go in there, and they wasn't there for a little while. Well, at that particular time, Roosevelt didn't do this because of his kindness of heart or any idea like that. They were fearful that there would be a revolution in the United States. Workers were sitting in plants. I remember in Flint, Michigan, trying to take over the plant. And they had to call out the National Guard. Eventually they settled it. But there were so many people unemployed, waiting in the soup lines, and trying just to get the next meal, which they didn't know where it's coming from. And there was such fear among the Roosevelt administration that there might be a revolution in the United States, what happened in Russia. In the United States, there was maybe about 100,000 communists at that time. And in Russia, they had also a small amount compared to the overall population. And that's why Roosevelt brought in these different programs, like the arts program, housing program, book programs, all kinds of programs to put people back to work. And that's why he brought in the New Deal, because he thought that there would be a revolution in the United States. It's not that bad yet in the United States, but it's moving along those lines. And when people are desperate, they do anything. That's why they go to drugs. That's why they go to heroin and other forms of things that'll calm their mind to a certain degree and let them relax for a period of time. So you have these different programs. And that's what's got to happen now. If you want to get people past heroin, the government has to step in. Of course, the Republicans won't let them do it at this time, but if things get worse and worse, they will do it eventually, maybe.
All right, next. Okay. Jane?
Please give me a 1 minute warning. The first thing I want to mention is that we talked about the American Dream. Well, who stole the American Dream? Read Hedrick Smith, Who Stole the American Dream. His answer to how we can get it back, read the last two chapters. The second thing is we heard about how much it costs to live in Chicago. Guess what? I pay $8.35 a month. I'm in a subsidized building. I got 13 windows, a superb view of the lake, and I've had an income since 1964, but I'm old. I'm the past. I had a real job. We don't seem to have real jobs for people now. I'm 79, not 19. luckily, I'm 79. The third point is, we talked about marijuana. Senator Staines, Senator Heather Staines, and Representative Kelly Cassidy, who are the representative from my district, the state senator from my district, now have a bill in to make marijuana illegal in Illinois. So there's some progress. Thank you.
Right, next.
Leave us.
Maybe recreational legal, that's what you want.
Well, I'd like to tell you a little story, a quick little story here about a man who found himself homeless and destitute.
No, it's not.
And he wound up going to a person who took pity on him and gave him a place to sleep for the night. And he told him the next morning that all he could do for him was give him a dollar, and that was it. And this guy didn't drink. He didn't smoke. He didn't take drugs. This man went on to become extremely rich. And I don't have to mention his name. Suffice it to say, he's the guy that invented the light bulb. So what I am saying is that when you give to the homeless, you basically encourage them to keep on doing what they're doing. Keep on being homeless. Keep on putting the bum on people for money and so forth. So the best thing you can do to help the homeless is not to help them. And if nobody gives them anything, most of them will eventually say, I'm fed up with this nonsense, I'll go work day labor, or I'll get with a church or whatever, and I'll get myself out of this hole, and I'll eventually get a job, and I'll get myself out of this. So by giving them, you actually hurt them. That's what I have to say.
Okay, next. Okay, 4 minutes. Just go ahead. You're going to pick up.
Good evening. My name is Debbie, and I'm from the Calumet River Creative Writers Group. I'm going to read a poem tonight. The name of my poem is titled The People of 2016. The sun begins to rise. Calm waters blend into a pastel sky. Fresh ozone permeates warm air. A fading moon opposes a reality that's tolerant and unfair. 5 a.m. brings joggers, walkers, and cyclists to Chi-Town's beach. Most seem educated, but ignorant to those in need. Scattered along the lakefront path are living quarters made from scrap. One can see a diverse array of homes, million-dollar condos in contrast to tents secured by rope. Where's the equality in this situation? Outreach programs manipulated by corporate pacification. Refuse workers hinder this perfect summer day. Hydraulic beeps scare the disadvantaged away. There's an attitude felt from those wearing neon vests. They feel they're better than others and screw the rest. Nobody along this trail initiates leadership skill. Morning greetings are lost and breakfast is denied to the ill. One would think someone might lend a helping hand toward the people of 2016 living underneath bridges and bunkered among sand. The majority of the people are very self-absorbed. It's a place to be seen, flaunting trendy, authentic wardrobes. As I study people passing by, it's a disrespectful fashion show that makes the homeless cry. So much emphasis is about vanity. Loud colored prints add to the insanity. Hollywood Beach is a place where people try to fit in. Designer labels and luxury items are an egotistical sin. I would respect the upper class if they channeled their selfish energy and helped a broken community who's been stripped of their basic needs. What happened to my people in 2016? Was it an addiction or others made you feel unclean? Could your trauma have been family related? Did you get fired from a job that you hated? Were you displaced from a college or school? We are the richest country in America where social injustice can be cruel. Stop and Smell the Roses are lyrics found in many songs. One day my people will have a special place where they can become strong. They will feel safe once again under God's divine grace. In these loving homes, my people will have a warm smile upon their face. Old memories of Lakeshore Drive will cease. My people will walk down Hollywood Beach and regain their inner peace. In order to reclaim the American dream, society will have to open up their homes and accommodate these precious kings and queens.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, Raj.
Hey, Raj. Okay.
My name is Raj Patel. I speak for myself. I live on near University Harbor, and we have a permanent homeless people living between practice golf course and University Harbor area, and the other group, which lives just across, if you put a line, then Lakeshore Drive itself, and they are living there. So they are there. Homeless people are all over the world. And you can talk endlessly about why they are and not. But I mean, like it or not, they are always going to be there. And do you know something? Your government is not going to do anything. And they are not able to do anything. They are not capable of anything. And do you know something? Your people are not capable of doing anything either. I mean, everybody talks here like they are a saint in a church. You know, that, hey, salvation is there. You know, come on, somebody. Problem is the devil. Devil is there. And devil, if you think the devil, you're going to be salvation is yours. It's not true. It is not true. And do you know something? It's going to get bad. It's not going to get better. Okay? Look at a very simple thing. Okay? What happened? So many jobs are going to go away. McDonald's is going to be an automatic car. Okay? Uber have a self-driving cars, then what will happen? Hundreds of thousands of jobs going to go away. And this is going to happen. And a lot more people are going to be homeless, or they are going to survive barely. And this is the reality. Okay? Now, if you want to solve homeless people, okay, anybody who can afford it, anybody who feels so hard, so bleeding hard, they adopt one homeless person. Say, hey, I'm going to work with you, I'm going to take you, and take care of you, and do it. Lots of people go and adopt children from all over the world. Okay, they can adopt homeless person. Nobody prevents you from doing it. But everybody wants to talk about this thing, you know, well, you know, only government can do, only rich people can go away and all that thing, you know. Come on, you know, what you are doing? Nobody's doing anything. Chicago must have at least 10,000 millionaires. or multimillionaires probably. They should compare to saying the prices of the condos on the lakes or downtown and everywhere. Prices you see 4, 5, 10, 20, 30, 50,000, $50 million. So I mean, you know, here you can do it. Your church can do it. Why churches are not doing it? Why church doors are locked at night and not available for homeless people to sleep? Why church, each church is not a soup kitchen? You know, why people are not contributing to people who go to church and who want salvation, they are not contributing to it. Okay, homeless people are not going to go away. And they are not going to be able to do anything. Like Dostoevsky say, the people's willingness to stick on to life is so strong. You know, he said that eternal darkness, just on a cliff, you have just barely a toehold. Still, to live is better than to die. And this is why poverty is there all over the world. And do you think these homeless people are getting bad? Go to a third world country, go to Africa, go to India, okay, go to China some places, okay, it's bad, in spite of everything. So, I mean, hey, guys, you want to do it? Don't talk, do it. Thank you.
All right.
Yes, I want to thank the presenters for what they've shown us. And it is a very, very ugly manifestation of what goes on in our society today. You know, and to drugs are a problem. Mental illness, anybody who's living under certain conditions is going to have a mental illness, I can guarantee you that. People who are incarcerated are going to have a mental illness. People who are living out on the street, riding the trains, doing whatever they do, they are going to have a mental illness, but it's environmentally caused by their circumstances. And as far as the housing situation, again, just to repeat, when I was coming up in the world, it was always understood that you never paid more than 25% of your income for housing. The average income for one person working in the United States is anywhere from $28,000 to $30,000. That's the median. So when you look at $1,600 average for a one-bedroom apartment in Chicago, it's absurd. And that's something that needs to really be underlined and pointed out, because the people who are bringing this about evade responsibility when there's too much of a focus on drugs and other problems that are going to befall that community. Now, I want to move to a little bit of a weather update, which I like to do. Just to repeat, the average global temperature from 1750 to March of 2015 went up 0.85 Celsius. We are now today at least 1.5. So that is what's known as exponential change. And so you go ahead and you extrapolate, where are we going to be at the end of 2017? Where at the end of 2018? And anybody who is a young person in your late teens, 20s, and 30s, you need to watch the data. Even though Trump is trying to completely remove access, you want to watch the data. And if you see it go up another 0.30 or more at the end of 2017, you know, you probably you know, want to be very, very careful about decisions that you make. If I was in that age group, I would not be wanting to have a child for about 2 or 3 years so I could see what actually happens and I could see if they're going to do anything about it or if there is anything to be done. One final update on that. There's been some comments from Vladimir Putin on climate change, and we all know what, you know, Trump thinks, that basically it's not really much of a problem. And it's a, you know, it's a plot to put down United States productivity. It was interesting to see that Putin has kind of a similar position. He says, you know, it's a natural process, as if that really makes any difference, because if it's a natural process that's going exponential, it's a huge problem. And then he also talks about economic opportunities. But up in Vladimir Putin's Russia, they reported this week that there are 7,000, I think they're called pingos. These are mounds, huge mounds, which contain methane. Okay. And just final to say, the methane is coming up very, very rapidly. It's serious. Thank you.
I'm going to try to be the fastest. I do supply chain management automation software. So I deal with global trade and transportation, warehouse management, and delivery management systems. So one thing that you may want to consider is what the future portends. And looking at the last 15 countries I've been in the last 5 years, I'll tell you that what it really portends is, in this country, we've got the first generation of children not expected to live as long as their parents. We've got a health disparity in Chicago zip codes of about 15-year lifespan difference between zip codes. We've got the current child obesity and overweight level that's over 30-some percent, which portends a $500 trillion a year increase in healthcare by the time they're adults. And that's with only a 4% increase in adult obesity. And the scariest thing to me to determine what direction we're going is that about 30% of today's jobs are obsolete. We haven't gotten rid of them yet, but they're unnecessary. And with the spread that is currently now, a wealthy getting wealthier and a middle class getting poorer into poverty, the indications aren't good that we're going to be in better shape in 5 years. So when I was trying to figure out what we could do about it, the only thing I came up with is that most of this homelessness, most of this despair comes from not having what the actual individual thinks of as a future. And if they don't see a future, they are hopeless. And if they're hopeless, then they might as well get a kick out of this moment. And unless you can get them occupied with something that looks like a future, you won't change the problem. And if you take the suggestion of just don't give them any other choice, then you have maybe not put yourself in their shoes. I will tell you right now, I've had a job since I was a child. And I was self-employed at 17 years old. But if I didn't have a way of making money legally, I will tell you I will do what everybody else would do in that situation. I'll get money illegally. So you will either get money legally or you'll take money illegally. And that will make all of you victims, because they don't take money from people who don't have any money. And if you look at the current trend, it's not like in 1968 when I was living in Chicago and we had riots and it was only in the poorest neighborhoods that they burnt down. Now there's a little bit more intelligence. They go where the money is. You're starting to see crime on Michigan Avenue and Naperville and in the places where the actual cash is. So if we don't deal with the actual problem of jobs, and the only way to deal with that is to change what we set up in the 1890s. And in the 1890s, when we had the Chicago World's Fair, we came up with, and this was after the Haymarket riots of the unions and things like that, but this is back when we had carriages and horse manure to shovel and kerosene lamps to light. In other words, we had lots of kinds of jobs. And that's when we came up with what was called the 40-hour work week. and overtime. With the current situation, if we don't change it to 30, if we don't change it to 30 hours, we won't be able to hire more people.
You know, I, in a sense, I'm really drawn in a quandary about this whole homeless situation. You know, just last week, SpaceX launched a rocket, brought the first stage down to a successful landing on an ocean barge. Most every homeless person you have today or know of has a little device called a smartphone, which means internet penetration has run in less than 20 years down to the most abject poverty level in the country. We've done a lot of great things through technology and through the development of society as a whole. What scares me more than anything else is when we want, I hear talk about deindustrialization, decoupleization from a global economy, and a general tariff raising barriers around the world, because I think we'd all be worse off without it. Thomas Friedman, in his book, in his most recent book, talks about this phenomenon. The world is speeding up. It is going to go into hyperdrive, and we're going to have to be ready for those changes to come through. And like it or not, if we don't do it, China and other countries will take our place. You know, if we don't trade with the world, China will. How does that affect the homeless in our country? Well, I hate to say this, but we're going to have to raise our taxes a little bit more. We're going to have to become a little bit more compassionate with those people who can't cope with the technological change. And surely there's enough work in the civic org, you know, between the cities and cleaning the place up and doing things that always will need to be done by lower skilled people or whatever. We should pay them to do it. Like the 1890 solution he was talking about, there's a lot that needs to be done, especially around cities and keeping the streets clean, keeping our blocks off, keeping our places going, rebuilding our water mains, rebuilding our infrastructure. And you know, even with all the technology that we have, surely we as a species can figure out a solution to this problem. I don't know exactly what that solution is, but I do know it has a lot to do with keeping cheaper energy going, getting our crops going, keeping a good source of clean water, and basically raising incomes above $8,000 a year, which is what it takes to keep the population in the country down to a sustainable level. I will not go into the solutions now because I think I'm going to outline a lot of those with Dennis Nelson in 2 weeks. But I will say, hey, we can launch a rocket, bring that first stage down on a barge. That's rocket science. Surely we can figure out a way to solve this homeless housing problem. Surely we can figure out a way to take care of those who can't take care of themselves. It's going to be tough because a lot of the stuff we've tried has not worked. You have to deal in with incentives and you also have to deal with stubbornness of people who don't want to change. I don't know what that's going to be, but surely we can figure out a way to do it.
Thanks, Dick. You guys ever heard of social?
Hi.
That's great.
Hello. I'm Ellen Corley, and this is my second time here. I actually studied this at the community colleges a little bit, and it's a great subject. Before that, I was a market research analyst, you know, studying numbers and things, which I'm now trying to bring to social issues. But regarding the number of homeless It said that in 2015 there were 125,800 in Chicago experienced homelessness at one point. Surprisingly, 50% of the people in Chicago's homeless population were people living within families. That means, you know, children were 35%, 43,900 children. Parents were 15%, parents or grandparents. The other, about 50% were single males or single. They don't say the breakdown of females to males, but the, you know, 46 are single adults. And 4% are unaccompanied youth. But surprisingly, 20% of the homeless in the homeless shelters, I think, of women are there for domestic violence, had experienced some domestic violence, which is something we forget about. I know when I was looking around for internships, there were hardly any for women, and there's a big need. I also studied the homeless from the Catholic Charities, which distributes a lot of the money for homeless, and only 3% of the need is found homes for. So someone here suggested, you know, if it goes up 1%, we still got a problem. Well, it's, they're expecting it will go up 7%. It's what kind of the experts say, unless we intervene. With Trump in, I don't know if there, that could even be more, you know. He certainly isn't interested in helping the welfare, education, or health, you know. There was one other, you know, in the schools, there's 42,000 children in our Chicago schools. It was up 62% in 2011 from 2009. That's just crazy. And you know, it's even bigger in the state. That's in Illinois. It's up 24% in Chicago. But I noticed that it seems to me the Hispanics, the immigrants, often they have to go very far out. We did a study. There's a computer program where you can imagine being homeless, and you know, you got to pay a bill, you know. And but one of the biggest, most interesting things, if you're pushed way out, and the, you know, transportation, access to jobs is absurd. I think of Chicago. I moved here in '95 from Georgia, but I think Chicago is a city that you would have thought, you know, would be a little more on top of this, though. Kari Lyerly's here. I read the book on Rahm Emanuel. I think he's a big problem. You know, he is, right, he definitely, he's made one, making the Chicago community colleges worse. He, as someone who's studying to be drug and alcohol counselor, you know, I had to go to Kennedy King, and, you know, there, it's, could be so much better, and it seems to be going in the wrong direction. Thank you.
First of all, with regard to the comments that were made about Roosevelt and his concerns about revolution, first, I don't give a damn why President Roosevelt put those programs in. It was enough that he did it at all. That's number one. And number two, he wasn't only concerned about revolution from the left. What about revolution from the right, which they were also afraid of at the time? They were afraid of somebody like the Nazis were going to come in. So that's number two. Number three, with regard to the comment that was made earlier about how we should not give the homeless any money because it only hurts them, well, some of us may or may not choose to give money to the homeless. But having said that, there's a part of me that to stand up here and advocate that, well, it feels like the Scrooge philosophy of life, at least to me. Finally, reference was made to global warming. Well, the Trump administration, at least if you listen to Stuart Spicer, the Minister of Propaganda and Popular Enlightenment, the White House press secretary, Well, he can tell you that they don't believe in it, but I think he's wrong, and I think most of us do too. Thank you.
Dennis, do you want to go up? Dennis, do you want to go up?
All right.
Did you want to make a statement?
Right. Yes, I do.
Okay, Dennis, let them.
All right, how much time we got? Are after we tired, or we?
No, you got 4 minutes, and then I'll be the last.
All right, Dennis. Let's thank Andy, our speakers.
Andy, I still have to go.
All right, come on up here then.
I'm Charlie Gold.
All right, I'll be eclectic as usual. I was looking at the figures today for Illinois cut in funding for the housing and urban development. If you go to my Facebook page, you can see that, how it negatively affects the housing situation in the state of Illinois. It's on my Facebook page, and I sent it around. Dr. Carson's going to do a number, and this guy Trump is going to cut housing pretty good here, which a lot of people depend on, it, at least from the federal funding. One thing about poverty here is that only in capitalist countries does one hear the expression, brother, can you spare a dime? I'm sorry, our speaker left there. There's two types of poverty. There's poverty of choice, which a lot of people think it's just poverty of choice. There's also poverty of circumstance. We spend a lot of time examining and criteria, doing an assessment of the attributes of the poor and the needy. Why don't we do an assessment of the attributes of the rich? And spend a commensurate amount of time doing that. Regarding panhandling, I was 13 years old and my dad thought I was mature enough. I had studied and tried working at it, but he thought it was time that I was going to be able to own my own camera. He took me downtown to purchase an Argus camera. And when I was waiting at the state and Congress for the bus home with my camera, and a bum came up, and then he apologized. I didn't hear what my dad said to him, what they wanted, but the guy apologized, and then he walked away. And I asked my dad, I said, what did you say that to that guy? He said, I'm working this corner, beat it. I've actually had an occasion being a railroad historian to study the hobo, which are colorful characters. But last of all, in the time remaining, seriously, from the perspective of the organized labor movement, I've seen this over and over again, time after time, in my office, the way our system is structured. And my apologies to the women who contribute to the workforce. But I see these men in my office, the union office, and what happens is, You get married, you meet a nice girl, you get married, and you buy a little hacienda, probably one you can't afford, have a couple kids, and then you spend the next 40 years, is what I say, and they know this too, the MBAs know this, that you're a captured piece. You're not going to look the boss, don't look at the boss in the eye. These people are responsible providers for their own. But housing entraps you for decades. And that's the system that we have. Until we escape from that and look at it, and I'm sorry, Tim, you have no idea, we've had 200 years of socialist literature, and you're searching for a solution. We've had a socialist guy who won half the states of the United States advocating socialism, and you go, boy, I wonder if I can find a solution.
It's got to be. It's got to be.
Boy,
socialism, all right.
All right. Thank you.
Dennis. Our speaker gets the last word. All right. Let's give a hand for Dennis.
I don't know what to do.
Hey, my name's Dennis Nelson. I personally dislike the phrase homeless person. I prefer the phrase transitional person. To me, transitional person describes a situation more accurately that such a person find themselves in, or they should, making the transition to a much better living situation where they're gainfully employed and have their own place. and there are programs out there to help people. When I was unemployed, I was a client of National Able Network. This is a non-for-profit that helps with job assistance. My job coach, Stephanie, is located at the Illinois Department of Employment Security's Pilsen office. National Able Network helped me update my resume and assisted me with my transportation expenses, like with Ventra passes. A friend who I used to work with a long time ago is at Pacific Guard Mission, a PGM in Chicago's South Loop, and PGM was mentioned this evening. I have visited him there, and I know a lot about Pacific Guard Mission. And I also know some guys who used to live in Tent City, that was also mentioned tonight in the presentation, along which was located along the Chicago River. Now, today is April 1st, is the first day of Earth Month. Now, you might want to say, why is Dennis talking about the annual celebration of ecological stewardship and environmental quality? What does that have to do with the homeless encampments in Chicago? And I'm going to make a very interesting twist in making a connection. Now, I've said on previous occasions that I am an experienced wildlife observer. I've logged literally hundreds of hours in the field identifying animal species. I've gone to county forest preserves and conservation areas, city parks, arboretums and zoos, national parks and forests, national wildlife refuges, state parks and nature reserves, and so on and so forth. Rescueville was mentioned tonight, the 62-acre stretch of undeveloped land on the south side, and I decided on two occasions to check it out myself. Now, it's located at south of the Roosevelt Road Bridge, and it runs to Tom Ping Memorial Park in Chinatown that was mentioned tonight. It's between Clark Street and the south branch of the Chicago River. So I took two nature hikes through there last year. The first was on Monday, May 30th, Memorial Day, and the second one was on Monday, July 4th, Independence Day. Now, I keep complete log sheets, lists of all the animal species that are identified on my nature hikes. And these are the two for Rescueville. And for Memorial Day last year, I identified 39 total animal species, including 31 bird species. For Independence Day, I spotted 37 total animal species, including 23 birds. And this is great. This is comparable to my other nature hikes in different places. So my conclusion is that Rescueville should be turned into Chicago Nature Park. And it's too bad that Mayor Rahm Emanuel doesn't spend some of this TIF money that we keep hearing about to make this happening instead of giving it away to all the corporate fat cats. There's enough existing infrastructure that can be sustainably developed to include gravel roads, well-maintained trails, and there's a spot for a new building which could be a nature center with the state-of-the-art green building techniques. Now, any of the remaining homeless people would have to be moved someplace else. I haven't been out there this year, and again, I got an update from the presentation, and there were piles and bags of garbage that I saw that they left, and those would have to be cleaned up. Now, I did have encounters with these homeless people. Memorial Day was pretty pleasant, but it got a little more confrontational the second time I went out on the 4th of July, and I'll be happy to talk with people about it because my time's up. Thanks a lot.
Okay, Andy.
Okay, as you can see, people are going around collecting glasses, and they're trying to get cleaned up, so we have to really start moving out of here at 8:45 to give them a chance to, you know, clean the place up so we don't run over our time. I'll be brief. There's, as I've talked about since 2007, I give presentations on censored news, blacked out news, how the media run coordinated blackouts on certain subjects while they simultaneously promote mythology on all channels 24/7. Well, there's one big myth they promote in America, they've been promoting it for about 40 years, and if we publish, we puncture that myth and live in reality-based world like other countries, there would be plenty of money for universal health care, plenty of money for universal shelter. We would not have a homeless problem like what we've seen tonight. We puncture that one big myth and transfer the money, you'd have plenty of money for living wage jobs,
You'd have plenty of money to build factories in America and have living wage jobs. You'd have plenty of money for quality schools everywhere, universal education, quality public schools like what we used to have in this country back in the 40s and 50s coming out of World War II. You'd have universal social security for everybody. People would be able to live in their retirement golden years with dignity and respect rather than being pushed into homelessness trying to survive on half the money or a third the money you need to get out of a homeless shelter. We have plenty of money to solve the global problem of climate change, global warming and climate change, which the American military considers the number one threat to the United States now. But our own military says it's not terrorism, it's climate change that is the number one threat to the safety of the American people. Well, that myth, that one driving myth that Martin Luther King talked about it before he was assassinated, he said any country that spends more money on the military and the machinery of death than it does on social uplifting programs is approaching spiritual death. And that's where we are. The rest of the world recognizes our 5% funding. We fund the largest killing machine that the human race has ever seen. And that killing machine right now is running child predators in our schools. They are called military recruiters. But many counter-recruiters, are publishing books recognizing that these child predators are going after our young people in record numbers, like some 40,000 a year basically go AWOL or get out of the military shortly after basic training with broken arms and legs. The child predator recruiters are recruiting people and signing them up to meet quotas in numbers that thousands, tens of thousands should never even be in the military. But that's what we've got. And you puncture the myth that the overriding myth is supporting 800 bases around the world that says our military is fighting for freedom and justice in foreign lands. That's not true. It hasn't been true since World War II. We are running 800 bases in a global dominance machine. It's the largest killing machine on the planet. And lately, it's been driven by the myth of homeland security, military police. All this stems from the myth that was planted in this country, a poisonous myth on the day of 9/11. Puncture that myth, and you can free up $1 trillion a year to solve all of these problems, especially the one they talked about tonight. Thank you.
Speaker gets the last word. Come on up. That's fine, but let's thank our speaker again.
Gosh, well, thanks so much for having me here. It's really been encouraging to hear, to see so much interest in this topic and hear all the really good questions and points. And so thank you very much. Just a couple quick things. And I really loved the poem. And it was great to hear about the wildlife survey. And unfortunately, they've already cut all the trees and destroyed everything at Rescoville. But there's that big U.S. steel site on the far south side, so maybe that plan can be used for there.
Condos and apartments and housing and commercial stuff that's going to be planned to go in there.
Yeah, it's going to be expensive housing, not affordable.
So, and then there's a few numbers I had mentioned. The point in time count, so thank you for looking up the numbers on the people experiencing homelessness, and that's massive. And then that point in time count I mentioned, that's when they count just on one night who's out on the street, and that was, or in the emergency rooms and things, that was 5,889 just on this one 24-hour period in Chicago in January of 2016. So that's supposed to be the rough number of chronic homeless at that one point. The total number, is much more in a given year. And with the heroin users, the national rate is 2 per 1,000. So by Chicago metro area, if you use that rate, that would be roughly 12,000 people. And Illinois is one of the higher
And I didn't have the Illinois rate handy, but Illinois is one of the states with the higher heroin use. So, you know, it's probably safe to estimate that Chicago metro area is maybe 15,000 users or so of heroin and synthetic opioids. Just the one other thing, someone mentioned bringing tents, giving tents to people. That's a great idea, like tents and jackets. Lloyd and I have given a few people tents. People really can use those and appreciate it. And food, and you know, I would, because there was debate about should you give money to panhandlers. I think if it seems right, you know, you should give money, but even better, like tents or things like that is an awesome idea. And then a few people mentioned climate change, and also you mentioned, you know, the global situation with housing and homelessness. I mean, it's true what we see in Chicago. There's a lot of countries just exponentially worse, you know, situation for people living in substandard housing or without homes. And, you know, with climate change, of course, that will probably get, right, no kidding, exactly. So, you know, that's, yeah, so I love how everyone linked all these issues together, and thanks so much for having me here.
All right. Yeah. It's time to go.
Hey, wrap it up, Tim. The College of Complexes stands adjourned.
All right.